It's also a great pleasure for me to be here because Tejinder is participating in this experiment, CMS. I'll tell you about that experiment. But what I'll do is also to give you a general introduction to our team and also try to not go into too much detail. So there are a few more slides which I will skip over because they are more detailed, but they could be of use to the others who are actually working on the CMS. What you have here are three images. The left-hand side image is the footprint of the accelerator in CERN in Geneva. CERN was an institution that founded in 1954. It predates the European Union. So it was the first pan-European organization, and it was dedicated to doing fundamental research. No state could afford to do this kind of work, so all the European nations got together and formed CERN. And what you see in this image is the footprint of the ground, which is 27 kilometers, 600 meters underground. And it's filled with the objects that you see in the middle, which are blue. These are superconducting dipoles, which bend the trajectory of the protons as they're accelerated. On the right-hand side, you see an eye. It's an electronic eye. At the heart of this detector, the protons collide. And we study the products of the collisions, as I will show you in a few minutes. Let me go back a little bit. I won't go back 2,500 years, but forward. So you all know there's a wonderful variety of phenomena in nature. And the attempt that we physicists are trying to make is to understand all of these natural phenomena using a single concept, a single principle. A unified approach, a unified view. This quest actually has started a long time ago. Nikolaev mentioned this issue of the Greeks and the Indians and the Chinese. And there were these notions of four elements that they were discussing. Of course, we don't discuss that any longer. But I think you have to imagine the intellectual leap that somebody has to say that everything you see is actually can be described in terms of very limited number of entities. And that is a fundamental leap of imagination. And what I show here is the apple falling, and that's conjectured to be what inspired Newton to also think, actually, the apple as it falls is the same thing that's happening to the moon. The moon is falling on the Earth, but it's coming at speed as it keeps going around. In that leap of imagination, he combined or unified two different phenomena, which was the gravity on the Earth and the celestial gravity. So the approach that I'm going to show you is an approach that he took, which we are still taking. And of course, the gravity itself was modified by the theory of general relativity of Einstein, which was 100 years old last November. And what I show you there is the GPS system working. And if you really go deep into how the GPS system works, you'll find that it requires you to understand Einstein's two great theories, the theory of special relativity and the theory of general relativity. And those are actually modifications which are made in the satellites so that you can actually follow, or somebody can tell you to turn right in 10 meters. So these kinds of theories do have enormous implications for our everyday life, and the next line is also something similar. Now, this is 150 years. Last year was also the next great unification that took place, which is the unification of electricity and magnetism, and we now have this theory of electromagnetism by Maxwell. And whenever one makes this kind of leap, it actually leads to altering the way we live. So a fundamental understanding of laws of nature give you paradigm-shifting technologies. So that's the second industrial revolution driven by electricity, the first one by steam, for example. On the right-hand side, you see an image of the sun. It's burning. And the way it burns is to use another fundamental force called weak interaction, which actually fuses protons together to generate energy. And in fact, it's remarkable that the theories that we write down, which I'll show you, the set of equations is rather simple. These are quantum theories. And they have such a predictive power that they can predict how a magnet works and what happens in the middle of the magnet. And there's also the image of a circuit board. Now, that is electronics. Now, if you open up the spelling of electronics, there's an electron sitting in there. And so our lives have been really changed enormously by the advent of electronics. But we couldn't have had semiconductor electronics without electromagnetism, without an understanding of atomic physics and quantum physics. So in there is a set of us, everyday things that we do, which are related to things which are very fundamental understanding of how nature works. So let me now open up a little bit more and look at what matter is composed of. So you're all familiar with the, let's say, salt crystal. It has a regular structure, it has atoms. And inside the atoms, you'll find electrons and nuclei. Electrons are negatively charged, nuclei are positively charged, and you form a bound system, the force being electromagnetism. And if you go and look deeper into an atom, you find that the nucleus actually has constituents, right? It has neutrons and protons. And if you look more deeply into neutrons and protons, you find other constituents called quarks and gluons, which is the top picture there. Now you can ask yourself some questions. Now I'm going to introduce a scale of energy, because we're going to be talking about high energy physics. So what is energy in this scale? So if I wanted to break free an electron from a hydrogen atom, for example, it's a bound system, so you have to inject energy to remove the electron. How much energy do I need? In fact, you need about 10 batteries of 1.5 volts. Because each 1.5 volts gives an energy equivalent of about 1.5, what we call electron volts. If I want to pull out a proton and a neutron from a nucleus, I need something like 10 million batteries. Now, what we are studying at CERN is not 10 million, it's not 10 billion, it's 7 trillion batteries. So that's the energy. So it is enormous energy that we're pumping in from the electricity grid into the protons. Now, on the right-hand side, you see the four fundamental forces. I've discussed gravitation. I've discussed a little bit the weak interaction, but it's also responsible for radioactivity, for example. And then the electromagnetic, which you're very familiar with. And the strong interaction, which binds the quarks into the proton. And the binding is done by particles, which are called mediator particles. So when a system is bound, the information has to be transferred from the binding objects to each other to indicate that they're bound. So this exchanges in terms of quanta of energy. And these quanta are called the mediators. So for example, the photon is the mediator of the electromagnetic force. And there are particles called WMZ bosons, which we found in 1983. In the previous experiments that I was working on. These bosons are very heavy, and I'll come to those in a minute. And the strong interaction, for want of a more imaginative word, the quarks are glued together by gluons. And all known forces in the world can be attributed to these. So what has happened in the last 100 years is that people have found more and more particles. As you find more and more particles, you ask yourself the question whether there's some fundamental symmetry underneath which actually gives you this diversity. Like in the periodic table of Mendeleev, you know that the structure there was actually given by the electrons, the number of electrons, or the number of protons, if you like, in the nucleus, which gives you all the elements. But basic constituents are essentially electrons and nuclei, which now we know are made of neutrons and protons. So this led to the construction of the standard model, which has a limited number of particles, which is shown on the left-hand side. And there are two types of particles. One are matter particles, and the other ones are force particles, the ones that actually mediate the interactions, as which I've just described. In the middle sits a particle called the Higgs boson, and that actually is the keystone of the standard model. Without that particle, we don't have a proper understanding of what the rest of the table is actually showing to us. It turns out that nature comes in three copies on the left-hand side, and matter that you see that we are made of, and anything else that you see is made of, only requires the first column. We don't really know why there are two other columns, although we have some inkling for that. So although we have a very good understanding, it is also a limit to our understanding. Now, the equations that you write that I mentioned earlier, which are actually quite elegant, and elegant and rather simple, and in fact you can fit them in the mug. Although if you open this mug up, it's actually 2.5 pages or 2 pages of equations, but it can be simplified to 4 lines. The first line actually describes the right-hand side of this table that you see there, which are the force particles, the fields. And the second line actually describes the left-hand side, which are the matter particles, like quarks, and the electron, for example. And the third line describes the interactions. You must have interactions in the way you don't have bound systems, and you wouldn't be here. And the fourth line is the one that describes the Higgs boson, which I'm going to talk about in a few minutes. So it's rather simple, but very profound, and these are quantum theories. The three of the four fundamental forces are quantum theories. The only one that is not having that is gravity, and we are nowhere near finding a quantum theory of gravity 100 years after Einstein introduced it. So this is called the standard model of particle physics. It's a crowning achievement of 20th century science. And before 2012, it's basic mechanism which gives mass to the particles was still missing. Now, I'm going to talk about particle physics, and I've actually alluded to some of those things. Particle physics is just a modern name for this centuries old effort to understand the laws of nature, started by Newton and Galileo in more scientific terms, if you wish. And the questions we ask are very, very simple. What are the elementary constituents that make up our universe? So everything that we see in the universe, not only us. And what are the forces that control their behavior at the most basic level? So those are the two simple questions. And for that, what we do is to make particles collide with each other and see what comes out. If there are systems which are bound by things or structures, when you smash them together, they'll come out and you'll be able to see them. And that's all we do. It's very rather simple mission statement, if you like. Why do we wish to accelerate particles to very high energy? Now I'm going to introduce three equations. On one side there'll be one letter, on the other side there'll be two letters. And that's it. But they're very fundamental equations. The first one is the energy is proportional to temperature. So this was put forward by an Austrian physicist called Boson. It tells you that if you have very high energies, you are mimicking very high temperatures, very high equivalent temperatures. We believe that the universe started as a Big Bang at very, very high temperatures. So if you are able to mimic very high temperatures, you are actually going back to the early moments of the Big Bang. Now, I situate you where the energy stands in this graph. So when we look back in time, it's like a really very powerful telescope. That's how telescopes work. They look at our universe in very early times. So very old stars, the light might have taken 10 billion years to get to us. The other one, which you're obviously very familiar with, is the Einstein's relation equals mc squared. So if you want to make heavy particles, which the Higgs boson probably is heavy, as we conjectured at the time, then you needed to put in a lot of energy. What this equation tells you is that energy and mass are convertible currencies. So if you have a lot of one, you get a lot of the other. Nuclear power stations is the other direction you take. And the third one is by a French physicist who wrote his PhD on this and got a Nobel Prize for this equation. The energy is proportional to inverse size. So if you want to look at something which is quite small in size, you need to have the radiation which has the commensurate wavelength. if you have a smaller and smaller wavelength, it has to have higher and higher energy. The equivalent energy is one of the wavelengths. So this means that you have a device, if you get very high energies, which is a very powerful microscope. So at the LSU, we do both. So it's the most powerful telescope we've ever built, the most powerful microscope we've ever built. And it allows you to observe phenomena and particles normally no longer observable in our everyday experience. And most importantly, we can do this in a controlled way. It's a laboratory. So we do it in a repetitive manner so that we can reproduce the results. So that make it into science. Now, this is a rather congested transparency. It actually describes the history of what our understanding of history of the evolution of the universe is. At the moment of the Big Bang, the four forces acted in equal manner. You couldn't distinguish between them. As the universe has expanded, it cools down, so the temperature goes down and down. So the temperature is extremely high at the early stages, 10 to 32 degrees. And there was a period of what we call inflation, where the universe expanded exponentially. And that's why it looks quite uniform if you remove the gross structures from it. It looks very uniform every which way we look. In fact, the cosmic microwave background radiation is uniform to 1 part in 10 to the 5. And after a certain moment, the strong interaction also becomes distinct in its action compared to electromagnetic and weak interaction. And a little bit later, those interactions also start to become distinct. As the universe keeps expanding, it keeps cooling down, and there are all sorts of particles present in there. And this is the stage we are at the moment, and there's an extra particle that we have in there. And later on, you start forming what's called a core gluon fluid. From there, you can form protons and neutrons, and there you can start forming atoms, and then structures, the galaxies, and so on. And that's what you see. So what we look at the LHC is a condition which is some like a fraction of a nanosecond after the Big Bang. So that's the time we go back to in the experiment I'm going to tell you about. We can also collide not only protons but lead nuclei at very high energies. So when the lead nuclei collide at high energies, there's so much energy that the neutrons and protons lose their distinctiveness and become a soup of quarks and gluons, a state of matter that existed a microsecond after the Big Bang. So that's another thing that we studied. So you can see that we are going back in time, and that's where the energy is rather important. So we're using 7 trillion electron volts per beam of energy. So this is what an interaction would look like. So it's an image. So this is a typical detector. This is a CMS detector. It's actually a cylindrical type of onion. It has 2 holes to allow the beams to come in and out, and the rest is all instrumented. And I'll show you the instrumentation in a minute, but let me just run this thing. So we have a beam of protons organized in bunches of about 100 billion protons coming in, so one bunch from one side, the other thing. And some of the protons collide, in this case one. And you're left with these tracks, which are picked up by our detectors, rendered into tracks by computing systems, and then you disengorge this from the detector, and that's the thing that you study. So that's what a collision looks like, and we look at the particles. We reconstruct the energies, the directions, and identity of everything that is produced in that collision. Now let me come to the science of the LHC. Newton introduced the concept of mass in his equations that he puts in. And mass is what gives the universe substance. And I'll say a few words about that. But there's also something else which is very embarrassing. What I'm going to be talking about will constitute about 4%. So the stuff that you made of, the table is made of, everything you see is made of, is only 4% of the energy that's in the universe. The other 96%, we still have to find what it is. So these are big, big stuff that we don't know. Also, we know that we are matter-dominated, but the conjecture was that the early universe was equal amounts of matter and antimatter. How did that antimatter disappear? We have some ideas, but it doesn't explain the extent to which it has disappeared. And so these are the sort of questions that started people, I think, to go into this field and also start looking at creating an experiment, I think, 5 years ago, to study these questions. Now, I've said a few things about mass, but let me actually introduce why the Higgs is such an important and fundamental issue. Now, to Newton, it was very simple, F equals ma, which you probably know. So it tells you that if you want to take a body to a given acceleration, the higher the mass of the body, the larger the force you have to put on, which is everyday experience. And the other part is the weight is equal to mass times the gravity. So the weight, our weight on the moon would be different from here. And Einstein actually escaped it. But he also introduced something quite fundamental, that mass curves space-time. So it tells the moon how to actually move, because the space around it has been warped by the gravity of the Earth. Now, all of this is very correct, but how do fundamental objects get massive? How does an electron get its mass? Now, just imagine if the electron did not have mass, so it was massless, it would have to travel at the speed of light. If it traveled at the speed of light, it could not form an atom. So we wouldn't be here. So this actually does go to the heart of our existence. And so in 1964, several gentlemen, six in fact, and one from Yale College, postulated there is a field that pervades the universe. They didn't actually quite understand what they were doing, by the way, because nobody paid much attention to those papers. It's only much later that people paid attention to it. Because a lot of progress had still to be made to put it into context. This came before actually the standard model that I showed you earlier was constructed. Now, it is a very strange thing to say that the universe is filled with something. And so it's a bold conjecture. And this is a sort of field that you can't switch off once it's switched off. So it's a very strange type of field. It's an omnipresent, omnipotent field. And particles which start as massless particles interact with this field and acquire mass. The strength of the interaction is proportional to the mass of the particles finally acquired. And since it's a quantum field, its quantum would be the Higgs boson. So if you found the Higgs boson, you know this field exists. So that is why this actually Higgs boson is so important. Now, in more general and more specific terms, there are a few other types of questions. So it's a rather similar transparency to the one I just showed you. But I just wanted to introduce one aspect, which is the second line in red, which is dark matter, which I'll come to in a few minutes. So this is a sort of a more detailed catalogue of questions we had 25 years ago. So this is a slide that I used to use a long time ago. Now, the study requires four things. One is accelerators, because I've told you that we need to go to high energy. So that's where the accelerators come in. Second is these electronic eyes, which are the detectors. I said a few words, and I'll say a few more words on that. The third is computing. Enormous amounts of data are generated by these collisions. In fact, there are 40 million pictures, if you like, are taken every second, and each picture has a size of a normal digital camera picture. So you have to analyze 40 million pictures a second. So you have to have a camera. So it's not an ordinary camera, this one. And that data then has to be analyzed. And if you just imagine your camera clicking, you can't take more than a few pictures a second. Because somebody's trying to read out what the CCDs or whatever devices that you have in your camera are actually outputting. And fourthly, it is collaborative science on a worldwide scale. No single country or region can afford this kind of stuff. And that's why it brings me here as well, because Malaysia University here is part of this collaborative adventure. And it's the talent and the resources of all of these scientists and engineers which are necessary to actually build these types of instruments and then do the physics as well. And the physicists are all democratic. So if an idea comes from here and it's a good idea, it is a good idea. Full stop. It doesn't matter where it comes from. So all scientists are treated democratically and they have democratic access to the data. They can take, even though they contribute maybe 0.5%, they have equal rights as scientists. So this is the Large Hadron Collider footprint blown up, and you can see on the right hand side the Lake of Geneva and the Airport of Geneva. Now, protons are accelerated by very powerful electric fields, and which give them a kick, very much similar to a kid's surf against riding the wave there. Instead of riding the water wave, the protons ride an electromagnetic wave. But the effect is the same. It gets accelerated. And they're held into orbit by superconducting magnets. And superconducting magnets, because you need to get very high currents and very high fields. Because if you get a high field, you can put higher energy into the accelerator, into a given ring, given radius ring. And they also cool to superfluid helium, which has a temperature of 1.9 degree above absolute zero. So this is colder than outer space, which has a temperature of 2.7 degrees. So this fluid is actually the second most perfect fluid that known to man. The first one is the whole plasma that I mentioned to you earlier. I won't say very much about that. So this is the second most perfect fluid mankind has made, and has very, very interesting engineering properties. It is a better conductor than pure copper, and it has essentially zero viscosity, goes through all sorts of pores, even liquid helium can go through. So these properties are used as engineering material in the accelerator. Now let me come to the detectors themselves. So the detector is actually a cylindrical onion. It has four principal layers, and each has a particular function. And all, when they work all together, they allow us to measure the energy, the direction, identity of all the particles that produce, in a manner that I said earlier. And they leave telltale signatures that tell you whether it's a proton, or an electron, or a quark, or a muon, and so on. So these are the particles that you saw in the standard model, in the table that you. So the idea is to be able to understand and identify those types of particles that you sit there. Because whatever you produce is likely to pass through the particles that we are familiar with of the standard model. So this is what an interaction actually looks like. So this is one of the early interactions. Protons coming from diagonally from top and bottom and interact, and we see lots of particles. You also see some collimation going on, some bunches of particles, and I'll talk to that in a few minutes. And this is the detector itself. Now, these are very complex detectors. Enormous amounts of engineering has gone in, and cutting-edge technologies, which even the industry was not able to at that time make, so we had to work with them to push them to make the things at an affordable cost. So there are 3,000 scientists from 40 countries, but a large fraction of them are actually PhD students. So it's a PhD factory. And I see quite a few young people there, and some of them actually have come over there to do their PhD. So it's a PhD factory as well, and they get trained in all sorts of things, in solving problems, because you'll have problems which you've never encountered before, because we're doing this for the first time. And they also learn to work in an international environment with very many different cultures, traditions, and languages. And the language that we all use is science, but it also happens to be we dialogue a lot in English. Now, these are the four principal layers, which look at the, if I look at the previous slide here, you can see that yellow is the first layer, red is the second layer, blue is the third layer, the fourth layer is not sun. And so this is what the first layer allows you to get: the yellow tracks, the red tracks, the blue ones, and this one was not in the transparency, and I'll show you later. Now, I will actually move on a little bit faster. There are a billion pairs of protons interacting every second inside the heart of these experiments. They lead to enormous fluxes, enormous radiation, so all the stuff that you put in there had to be radiation hard and very fast to allow us to separate out all sorts of particles that are being produced. An enormous amount of data, 40 terabytes per second being generated. And the picture of it has to be in any one of those. And so you have to look at all of them. And so that is a big challenge. And we weren't sure that we could actually meet the challenge when we started 25 years ago. But then we have to innovate, we have to invent, and we have to drive the cost down. So one of the things was the detector that actually detected photons from the Higgs boson, which is one of the signatures, which was thought to be probably the only signature if the Higgs boson had the mass in the region in which we found it eventually. we had about 3 or 4 crystals which were available to us at that time. And they're using photo devices which now find applications for positron emission tomography cameras. And they're about research samples, 2 or 3. So we need about 75,000 crystals and having 50,000 of these. And it took us 10 years in a Russian ex-military factory working around the clock to make these crystals. So we had to deal with the ministers of science and also to get some signatures from a person called Putin to use platinum that we needed from the Russian Federal Reserve. So the reason I tell you all of this is that it's not only the science, it's not only the engineering of all sorts, electronics, cryogenic, mechanical, computing, software, but also aspects which are related to finance and how to handle budgets and diplomacy as well. So these are experiments which actually call on all of this. None of us are present to do anything, but we do succeed. So this is it shows you a few slides. Each of these crystals takes about 3 days to grow in an atom, and you have to then shape it into crystals of a given size, polished, turned into 400 crystals, 1700 crystal modules, and then something quite important has to happen. You have to put electronics in. And so at the back of the crystals, at the back of this, what we call the avalanche photo diode, which is a photo detector that detects light. So this detector works, a photon goes in there, generates an electromagnetic shower of electron and positron, very large number of them. These excite the atoms inside that substance, which is their tungsten. When they de-excite, they emit light. The light is picked up by the photo detector. The amount of light is proportional to the energy of the incoming atom. That's how you measure it. But to do that, we have all of this electronics. It's about this thick amount of electronics. And when we finished with this, this was meant to be closed and has been closed for 10 years now. And it's going to be closed for another 10 years. And you can't touch it. If you want to touch something, it takes us about a year to get to it. And fortunately, in the last 10 years, we've only lost about half of the set. So that also means that whatever we put in this, these detectors must have an extreme high quality of assurance and control. It's as if you're going to send these experiments into outer space, and they weigh 15,000 tons. So that's a philosophy. So that's another aspect to understand about these detectors. They are really very complex instruments. And that's the object that's finished. Now, I tell you something about another type of engineering. So the CMS experiment was actually constructed on the surface, and then lowered, it was the cylinder, or the cylinder lining was sliced into 15 slices. They were assembled upstairs, there's a lot more room. Underground, these are things which have a size, which is about 40 meters in length, 15 meters in diameter. So underground, there are cathedrals, if you like, which was housed in these experiments. But on the surface, there's a lot more space, as you can see it. This particular photograph shows a central element, which has a solenoid. That coil there is a solenoid, a very high field solenoid. Generates a high, very high magnetic field for measuring the momentum of the planet. And it weighs 2,000 tons. It's a few centimeters above the plate that you see there. It's on rollers which are in the bottom, which are orange structured. And the crane is on the outside of the building. So I'm going to click, and it's a time-lapse photography. And you can see the first thing that happened is the cover plate is retracted. That's something like 6 meters of reinforced concrete. We started about 6 o'clock in the morning. You can see the light coming in because this now becomes light. And this thing is takes about 10 hours to go down. And it has to go extremely straight because the clearance on either side is 1 hand's width. If you make even a slight tilt, the whole thing would have been jammed and we wouldn't have had an experiment. And so this is the object coming and landing at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And you can see lots of people looking. Now, inside this coil, the barrel, if you like, or the coil, three types of detectors are going to go in. And their cables and their services, low voltage, high voltage, optical cables, cooling systems, and so on, have to actually be put on. So that's another aspect of engineering which you have to then deal with. And 7 months later, you have this kind of picture. So the coil is now lined with stuff which there are connections every which way. And again, if something goes wrong in that, it takes about 6 or 8 months to get there. So it had to have a very high fidelity of connections and connectivity. And everything must work. And it did, and it does. This is the detector closed, ready for taking data. So now you can get some idea of the size of the cavern, because down here is a man, just there. So this is now sitting in a cavern underground, and there's the beam coming. So the proton is going to come in here, and that's just by the hole, and there's one on the other side. And if you go this way, walk 27 kilometers, you end up on that side. So the operation of such experiments is like, as I introduced to you, a digital camera. Now, imagine yourself that you were given a camera and you were told that you're a fraction of a nanosecond after the Big Bang and you have a camera in your hand and you're taking pictures. Because that's what's happening. So you have a camera which is taking pictures of events that are taking, that would have been taking place a fraction of a nanosecond after the Big Bang. The universe was very simple at that time. There was no structure. They were all particles. And they were interacting with each other, producing new types of particles, some which we now know, like the Higgs exist, some which we're trying to find, which may or may not have existed at that time. But you can make them. So your camera actually is looking at taking pictures of these interactions. They happen to be a particular set, because they have to start from the constituents of the proton, which are quarks and gluons, so they have to start like that. But there are other types of particles in the universe at that time. But those particles can make other particles that existed at that time. So that's the idea. And in terms of the data handling problem, clearly you need a very sophisticated high bandwidth communication systems, which you most of it we bought, which we buy. Commercial usage is needs of everyday person are larger than our needs for that particular purpose. And it's 10 million gigabits per year that have to be actually shared around. And I'm going to say a few words, and I have a few more examples in the background, so can be asked. The notion here is that when you do fundamental research, you're trying to do something for the first time. And sometimes the technologies you have to get to your results, in this case physical results, doesn't exist. So you have to invent it. And there have been a few cases. One of them is this one here, which is the World Wide Web. And that was because people in the 90s wanted to share. LEP was starting, which is a previous accelerator. And the scientists wanted to share data. And so this system was set up. And this is a picture of a letter, two-page letter document, signed by the director of research. And I'll blow it up. And it was signed on 30th of April, 1993. And here, CERN, I read it, CERN relinquishes all intellectual property rights to this code, both source and mining form. Permission is granted for anyone to use, duplicate, modify, and redistribute it. So that means CERN gave this free to everyone. And the code was given. So it's not that old, but now imagine how much it has changed our lives. And that's what actually paradigm-shifting technologies do, like electric bulb, if like compared to candle. So those are the kind of things which come out of doing this fundamental research and the understanding we get, because it allows us to generate new technologies which didn't exist before. So let me go to the science of the last 25 minutes. Now, we've now built the experiment. The first thing you've got to ask yourself is, does the experiment perform as we designed it? Because we wanted some performance from these detectors. And did we get it? And then the next thing is, because we want to find new physics, but then you must reproduce the physics that is known precisely. So you can't have something that was discovered, not to be discovered in an experiment, or measured at a given rate, which has been established before, and you find a different rate. That means you have an unobjective detector. So those are the two fundamental steps you have to make before you can say, I want to now look for new things. In fact, what we normally do is to look most of these things in parallel. So I will now tell you just a few slides. So this is a particle that merited the Nobel Prize in after its discovery in 1983. This is the Higgs boson. This is the mediator of the electromagnetic and weak interaction, sorry. And that actually is why I'm going to Singapore after this meeting, because the person who postulated got the Nobel Prize was Abdus Salam, who was at Imperial College, and they held a meeting in his memory in Singapore, and his theory predicted the Z boson, which had not been predicted before. So when we found Higgs boson, that was the ultimate proof that the theory was correct, although he got the Nobel Prize earlier, so it hadn't been established earlier. And in this particular case, the Z boson decays into two muons. So these are particles which are in the fourth layer. So they leave a track in the first layer, nothing in the second, nothing in the third. That's why it's not shown here. And the fourth layer, you can see the track going through. And so these are two muons. So what we normally do, if you have two particles, what we try to do is to make what we call an invariant mass. So you take the momentum and the energy and the direction of the two particles and create an invariant mass, the mass from which the object will have come from. Now, if, when you look at all sorts of pairs of these such particles, there is a peak somewhere, meaning at that particular mass, there are a lot more combinations, and that's the sign of a particle. And that's the next plot here. So you can see these are dimuon pairs with two invariant masses. That's the mass, and this is the frequency, and this is the log scale. So these were the particles that were known in the 1960s. This was found just before I started, on the month I started my PhD, and merited the Nobel Prize. This was found in 79, merited the Nobel Prize. This is in 83, merited the Nobel Prize. So this is what a particle looks like. It is a peak in a spectrum, which is the background. So these are pairs of neurons coming from random coincidences. So randomly produced, they have no particular memory, there's nothing particular about them. And so they constitute a background. So that's, well, in a few minutes' time, I'll show you the experiment. In fact, what I also wanted to show you was that when we designed this, we wanted a certain width. This thing is now blown up, this plot here, and we wanted a certain width, and the width was 70 units, 70 MeV. That was the design, and we measured it to be 64. And there are tens and hundreds of plots like this which told us the experiment is working as we designed it. The next thing is, does it produce physics as we expected it to be? So I show you this plot again. Now, this bunching of particles that you clearly see comes from the fact that you have produced quarks and gluons, the proton has interacted and sent the constituents at large angles. And these constituents actually cannot manifest themselves as the constituents as we see in the standard model, because they form other types of bound states which are called colorless. And they then, what we call, fragment into bunches, collimated bunches of particles, and that's what you see there. So these are the primary constituents of the proton that you see there. And you draw a cone around this, measure the energy, and you say, I have a theory, and the theory is the theory of strong interactions, the quantum theory of strong interactions, called quantum chromodynamics. Color here is a quantum number, so chroma comes from color. And it predicts precisely how many you should see at that angle, and what the energy spectrum should be at that angle. How many at this angle, and what spectrum should be. So you measure, and you go compare. And that's the next plot there, on the right-hand side. So that is a plot where we've compared over about six or seven orders of magnitude the predictions of this quantum theory of chromodynamics and our measurements. So there are, again, hundreds of plots of this nature which tell us the experiment actually is working well and is reproducing known physics extremely precisely. So in fact, we've done it again because we increased the energy, and these are results from last month, from December. So we repeated the exercise, and again, perfect agreement. In fact, you can look at many different processes, and the lines are the predictions of the theory and points are our measurements. And you can see there's not anyone that is discrepant as such, which is a little bit of a disappointment, because we'd like to see something new, but the standard model is very robust. So that's something which I'll come to. So now we can go to looking at new physics. So I mentioned that the menu that I showed you had the Higgs boson as being one of the possible particles. But there are many other things that we think should be there, because the standard model on its own really doesn't make sense. It is incomplete. We know it is incomplete. It doesn't explain many of the things that I'll show you in a few minutes. So, at least the discovery has been recognized by Stockholm. But I wanted to pick up the role played by the experiments in showing the red. And it's only by doing the experiments that these guys actually could go to Stockholm. In other words, it's only by doing the experiment that you can prove a conjecture. Otherwise, it remains as a metaphysical conjecture. So the experiments are really very important to do. And if you stop doing experimentation, you'll in the future go into the realms of metaphysics. That's why I wanted to pick that point. Now, once you actually look at this Higgs boson, again, that same diagram that I showed you, actually can decay into B quarks, tau leptons, sort of cousins of the electron, or the Z and W bosons, or two protons. I'll only look at those two channels to show you. And because I said that the strength of the interaction is proportional to mass, you know exactly how many two photon events, because these goes to two protons, you should get. You also know from the predictions how many ZZ bosons you should get. And if you see them to be the precise quantities that were predicted by the standard model, then you know it is the standard model Higgs boson. Of course, there'll be an error, because you can't make a measurement, especially at the start, to very high accuracy. Our accuracies are going to be at a 10-15% level, and we'll be looking for deviations at the level of a percent, finally. So let me actually perhaps go a little bit faster on this one. There are various things that we have to do, but what I wanted to pick up is the box there. So we examined in the previous round 2,000 trillion proton-proton interactions. Remember, 1 billion pairs interacting every second, and we would have produced 600,000 Higgs bosons. And the previous plot, actually it's the next one, it shows once you produced it, it has to decay in various ways. And the ones that we can actually pick up very cleanly at the LHC are into two photons and two Zs. Into two photons, it goes only 1 in 1,000. So although we produce 600,000, we'll only see 600 before you put in efficiencies, and when you put in the efficiencies, only 300. So 300 out of this 2,000 trillion. If you look at the ZZ, it's 1 in 10,000. That means you'll only see something like 60. And once you fold in the efficiencies, it'll be about 30. So you're trying to dig out 30 pictures out of 2,000 trillion pictures. Not an easy job, but possible. And with high efficiency. So this is what an event to ZZ on the left-hand side to the gamma-gamma on the right-hand side would look like. So you see the second layer is singing. In this case, the first layer is also singing because it's electrons. They're charged particles that leave a trace in the first layer. That's how we know that these are electrons. And these are photons because they don't leave a trace in the first layer, so you know it's a photon. So these are the types of events that you get. And when you have to do the same sort of thing, like create the invariant mass, this is what you see. In blue is what you expect from known physics. And you clearly see that there's a peak here, which is not predicted by known physics at the time. And here again, you should see a smooth background, and you see a bump. So again, something similar to what I showed you earlier. And it turns out that this bump and that bump appear at the same place, and in ATLAS and CMS at the same place as well. So that means you've made a discovery. And that actually was the excitement of 2012. Now, to build a picture, so to give you an idea that it's not something which is instantaneous, when you take data, as you accumulate, the strength of the signal appears stronger and stronger. And I'll show you the various stages of the experiment in one of the channels, which is ZZ. So if I now stop it, you are going to be guided by this red peak there. But at that point, which is something like what happened at the end of 2011. You can't really say that you found anything. You might say that there's some hint in that area, and that was what it was. There was a hint. So what we then did was to say, we'll blind this area and not look at it, but we look at this part and that part, just so that we don't bias ourselves. So we blinded, we called it blinded, and then we took some more data, and this is the situation in July 2012. And there, now this is, although it might not be very clear to the eye, statistically analysis indicated this is a pretty strong signal. And then you went until the end of the year, sorry, I should go back, to the end of the year, and then you clearly see the peak, and then you can't miss it. So that's how evidence comes in. The reason I show you this is because I'm going to tell you something exciting at the end. We shall see in 6 to 8 months' time whether that's a discovery or not, but that's how it happened. Now, this Higgs boson looks very much like the standard model one, because when you actually look at, you divide the numbers and divide it what you expect, if they equal, then you see one. And this is one here. And there are various combinations and ratios which are looked at. I won't have time to go through this. They all seem to line up. And the value that we find between what is predicted and what is seen is 1 plus or minus 0.1, so 10% measurement in a sense. It's insufficient to tell us whether this is the standard model Higgs boson, because, as I'll tell you, there's a symmetry called supersymmetry, which I'll tell you in a few minutes, predicts 5 Higgs bosons. One of them would be subtly different from the standard model one, so you have to make a measurement which is rather precise, and that's what we're going to do. It has the other properties, like its relation to mass, which I mentioned earlier, which is correct. We do the errors. It has spin. It's a zero plus object. It doesn't have spin. It's another quantum number. We'll not have to go into that. And it's right one. So then comes the question, is this it? We found what we're looking for. So why spend another 15, 20 years, which we are going to? What for? So, the question actually arises the fact that there is a lot of experimental evidence that there is something beyond the standard model. One is that the neutrinos have mass and they oscillate. And this year's or last year's Nobel Prize was given for the detection of these oscillations, which was done in the late last century, early part of the 2000s. Another thing is that a deep question, which it was in my list that I showed you, and I didn't go through that, is that we knew that if we did find the Higgs boson, the next question will be, actually, why did we find it in the place at such a light mass, at the mass that we could actually make it? Because it turns out that if you really trust quantum mechanics, which we trust implicitly, it actually generates what's called loops, which actually make the mass of the object float up by quantum corrections to very high values. The value which would be the next scale up, which we know is by 10 or 15 GeV. So you have 100 GeV object getting corrections of 10 to 15. Doesn't really make sense. So there's a problem there. And it's quite a deep problem. And we've had these problems and we always find solutions in something new. This is not a new problem, but it is there. A big problem is the dark matter. We know that it exists on the rotational curves of stars and galaxies. They're rotating too fast, which indicates there's more mass than that we see. We see in stars. So that's the visible matter. And so this is matter, which is gravitational in effect, but we don't see. So it's called dark matter. And that is 25% compared to the 5% or 4% of the matter that we do see, that you and I and everything else is made of. So it's a big problem. And there's also matter-antimatter asymmetry. There's also, more recently, dark energy. Our universe seems, expansion of our universe seems to be accelerating. And when you have that happen, if you only have matter, it only attracts, gravity only attracts, it can never push. So if the expansion is accelerating, there's something in the universe that is pushing things away, or some sort of an anti-gravity, or some sort of a negative pressure. What is it? And that's 70% of the energy matter density of the universe. So these are big, big numbers, and they're experimentally confirmed in a sense. So there is actually another standard model. It's the standard model of astroparticle physics, of cosmology. And their data comes from similar types of ambitious experiments, in this case Planck satellite. And it has all sorts of parameters which go into this. One of them is that the age of our universe is 13.799 billion years. So that's a parameter that you put in there. So it's 13.8 billion years. Slightly different from what it was earlier, which was 13.6. And so this is the two standard models. And we are made of this little punch. All of this, we don't know what it is. We have some ideas of what this might be. I'll come to that. So let me come to one way of solving this problem of these quantum corrections is that to understand in quantum mechanics that if you have a loop which has a loop with a particle called a fermion, spin half, and you have another possible identical loop with a particle which has spin 0 or 1, which is a boson loop, in the amplitudes they come in opposite signs. If you add them together, they sum up to 0. So you don't have the problem. And that symmetry comes about if you put fermion particles and boson particles in the same group, meaning the left-hand side and the right-hand side of that block are considered to be in the same group. And that's called supersymmetry. It is a symmetry which nature must have used because it's something which, whether it has used it at our energy, we don't know. But that symmetry predicts a new class of particles. Every particle has a superpartner. This is not unusual because Dirac, about 100 years ago, predicted that every particle should have an antiparticle, and it does. So it's not unusual to have that happen. But we have to verify that. But it predicts some like five. It goes on, it predicts a particle which is sitting here, which is the lowest, lightest supersymmetric particle. And that particle could well be a particle responsible for dark matter. So if we actually see supersymmetry, then we might get an explanation for dark matter. And that's what we're looking for. So, and the way we look for is to see events which are completely imbalanced. Because this lightest supersymmetric particle as the property doesn't interact very much. So it behaves like a neutrino. It leaves the experiment and leaves an apparent imbalance. So if there's a particle which goes away which you haven't detected, it has to be balanced by energy momentum conservation. So you see an unbiased event, a biased event, if you like. You can see nothing on this slide. So that's the sort of thing that you're looking for. This can happen also in the standard model. So you have to have a number of such events which are much and above beyond what you expect. That's why the understanding of known physics is so important. So this is a table showing that it hasn't turned up. And then let me come to other types of things. I won't have time to go into very many other types of things, but a couple I will go through. One is gravity. I mentioned this earlier, we don't have a quantum theory of gravity and we're struggling with it. We're struggling to understand why gravity is so weak. It's obviously very strong because it holds us, but we are massive bodies. In our experiment, we don't care about gravity, it never comes into our calculations. That equation that I showed you did not contain gravity. So why is it so weak? And some people conjecture that it's probably weak because we don't live in four dimensions, three of space and one of time, but in a larger number of dimensions. Now, the physicists from real know that it's not easy to think about higher dimensions. Even three is pretty tough. But you can go back to two. If you go back to two and look at Gauss's zero, lines of force, Faraday, if you like, and then you see what the electromagnetic or gravitational interaction would look like, you'll find that it is not 1 over r squared, but it's 1 over r. Because the number of lines of force, the density decreases in 1 over r in two dimensions and 1 over r squared in three dimensions. In fact, in nine dimensions, it will be 1 over r to the power of 8. So it could be very strong, very close to zero distance. So it could be that the gravity is actually is strong, but not at the scales that we're looking at. So in fact, there are different types of theories about extra dimensions. And possibilities where they predict particles which would look like the Z boson but much higher mass. So what we do is look for these things, and we haven't found them yet. So again, we're looking for these things, And you look for all sorts of things. Earlier somebody mentioned black holes. So the black holes are somewhere here. Gravitons, we get them inside the brain. So all sorts of things. Dark matter. And we haven't actually seen them. So these are really platforms for doing science. We're looking in many, many different directions to see what nature has in store. So what is it that nature has in store? The accelerator will operate for another 15, 20 years, because we are going to increase the number of interactions that take place per second from 1 billion to something like 5 to 7 billion, because we can accumulate faster, make more Higgs bosons, to make more rarer processes, rarer particles, if you like. And that's the idea. And so the things to do is to also study particles that we have found, which is the Higgs boson, in great depth. So to do that, you produce a large number of them. That's always the case when you make a new discovery. It takes you quite a long time to understand in what context you've made that discovery, in exact detail, usually about 10 years. Now, I said there was something tantalizing that was shown last in December. This is now diphoton. So you look at two photons, very much like what we said about the Higgs boson, but not the mass of 125 GeV, but a much higher mass. Now, what actually the two experiments have seen is this. Atlas, you see this little bump there, and CMS has a little bump. These things are lined up a bit. And so you do a statistical analysis, and this is called a p-value, the probability that the background could have fluctuated to give you that peak. And normally you want that probability to be smaller than 1 part in 10 to the 5. This is not quite at that level. It's 1 part in a few parts in 10 to the minus 4. So, but the interesting thing, which is I show you now the same plot, but lined up now on the mass scale, the two experiments see in the same place. Now, is that a coincidence? If it is not a coincidence, and we confirm it, then that, in my books, will be a discovery bigger than the Higgs boson, possibly rivaling DNA, rivaling the work done by the people in the 1920s in quantum mechanics and relativity. Because it will tell us something about what is beyond the standard model. We don't have a clue. So this could be something very important. On the other hand, it could be something which is a coincidence, an accident, that the two things have lined up, because you can see lots of little peaks there, and we see them there as well. So it's is it an accidental lineup? If not, it's a big deal. So, and for this, if that were to happen, then clearly one of our parts of the program is to improve our detectors. And this is where also, you know, physicists here, scientists and engineers here come in. Because this program is a long-term program. And there are new detectors to be built. These are going to push the boundaries of technology. And one of the good things about participating in these experiments is to access this technology, and perhaps also make it here, in parts of the experiments here in Malaysia. But let me just now wrap up and put into context what I just said. So this is another picture. This is a picture of a composite picture of two clusters of galaxies which have collided. They've gone through each other at extremely high speed. And you can see the stars which have been picked up by the optical telescopes, which are Magellan and Hubble. And you can see gas, which is in red, picked up by Chandrasekhar telescope, infrared. And you see blue, which is picked up by gravitational lensing. If you have a very dense body, the light is shining behind you. Light bends like this, round to you. And you then project it and think that it's coming from there, because, as Einstein said, light is bent by massive objects. And that's where this blue part comes in. The blue part actually contains about 5 times the matter that is in the red part, which is gas, essentially. So, So this actually indicates the dark matter in these universe, in these galaxies has gone right the way through. It has not interacted. The cloud has interacted and coalesced. So that's electromagnetic interaction. This is the weak interaction. That's the properties of the lighter supersymmetric particle. Exactly those types of properties. And another one is the fact that I was mentioning earlier that the universe, the expansion is accelerated. It turns out that if you have a collection of Higgs bosons, they exert negative pressure. So is there a connection between what we have found, the scalar field impact? That there was a sort of a scalar field which is operating now as well. And there was another scalar, type of scalar field which drove inflation because the universe expanded exponentially. Are there these connections? So in a sense, the work that we're doing actually does have really very, very strong impact on other disciplines in science and our place in the universe as such. So let me summarize. The construction of the standard model is, I think, a towering intellectual achievement. Actually, it is the, I think, the highest achievement in science, because it actually describes the visible matter and many of the phenomena in quite exquisite detail, quantitatively as well. But there's a lot that is put in by hand, which, if he had a perfect understanding, he would get everything out of first principles. So there's a lot more to do, or that indicated. It has taken a lot of time, 25 years, and also the aspect of the technologies and the engineering that had to go in there, pushing them to the limits. A great discovery has been made, and we haven't really found any evidence for new physics. And the other thing is that it's just the start, because we've had 4 years of data taking, and we've got 15, 20 years to come. So we're actually at the start of this journey, which has already been quite long, because we have to make these detectors to start off with. And I think the other thing is that only experiments really confirm or reveal nature's secrets. So we really have to be doing these experiments. And with that, thank you for listening.
Thank you, Professor. And now we will open our question and Q&A session for 15 minutes.
Oh. Maybe from the back of the room with the younger people first. You feel shy.
It's probably a conjectural question, but when you define new physics, right, for Rental specifically as a physics that may destabilize the current conceptions of the standard model, or will it be more of like confirming what we already know, or to probably give more evidence, you know, of some of the problems that the standard model actually currently faces, as be with the graviton, for instance?
I think let me take the analogy with the way Einstein modified Newton's description of gravity. It doesn't mean to say Newton's description of gravity is wrong. It still applies. So, for example, when you launch satellites, we don't worry about Einstein, so we use Newton's. So it's the realm of applicability. So we know that the standard model is very successful in describing phenomena which have energies which are less than the order of 100 GeV. So you don't, that is fine. But when you go beyond and you start looking at the problems of the standard model, there are others. So that's where we look for the reasons. And also the fact that the standard model does not explain quite a few things. It doesn't explain dark matter, it doesn't explain dark energy, it doesn't explain human masses, although you can probably put them in hand, by hand, I suppose. So in fact, also, a lot of the parameters in the standard model, there are actually 19 parameters, they're actually determined by experiment, then you put them in, and then you get your answers. So it's a solid foundation. It has its realm of applicability. We believe at higher and higher energies, it will break down. And it's incomplete. It's not break down, it's incomplete. It's in this way that you look for new position. And it's not having you looking for, because our theorist friends say, look this way, look that way, look that way. But maybe we should be looking that way. We don't know. And that's why, as an experimentalist, it's fun, because we like to prove that our theory friends were not quite right. I don't know whether it does answer your question.
For the next question. I mean, sorry, excuse me. This could be a bit of an off question because I'm not following things for a while. But it seems that probably one of the biggest losers in all this is string theorist. I'm not sure what happens to them, you know, that kind of thing. And how, you know, you've been researching this for many, many years, how do they take it that they have to sort of disprove and, you know, change to another field?
I wouldn't say necessarily losers. Perhaps I did have superstring in my talk when I passed it throughout the past. The string theory has there's a fundamental problem in physics. We have two pillars which work extremely well, and it stands on these two pillars. One is quantum mechanics, the other is a general zero relativity. And in extreme circumstances, one of them breaks down. And so they do not live in peaceful coexistence in extreme conditions, and we don't know why. The problem arises, for example, if you take, I'll answer your question in a minute or so. Take a particle. All I've been saying is fundamental particles. That means they have no size. So if you don't have size, and then you can create an energy by fluctuation can be very high. And if you create by these quantum fluctuations, pair creation, if you wish, then you actually momentarily get in very high energy density. Heisenberg's principle tells us that that you can have you can borrow a lot of energy for a very short time, smaller energy for a longer time. But if you borrow for a very short time a lot of energy, you are going to modify space-time. And that's where the problem comes in. So you bring in infinities, the space-time looks completely odd. And so that's how quantum mechanics causes a problem. Now, if you were to say that the particles actually do have a size, and the size will be the string. And in fact, you can build self-consistent theories of particles. The problem is there are about 10 to the power 500 of these theories, or types of string theories. So which one is the one that is actually relevant? Of course, one wouldn't be because of a large number of them. So it's not the fact that the string theory itself is not a viable candidate, the only candidate that can incorporate gravity. And the super comes from supersymmetry. So there's a built-in symmetry which we are looking for in those theories. So let's see what happens. So if, for example, we find supersymmetric particles, the string theory will get an impetus to go further. So again, I think in fact, for the experimental physicists, it's a nice moment because it has to be the results that tell us which way to move. We have had 40, 50 years of thinking, and we haven't really found the most promising way, because it's not what the promising way is, what the right way is, what nature has chosen, not the right way, what nature has chosen.
Okay, I think we can have one more question.
Thank you for that nice presentation. I just have a question. There is a consensus that if you accelerate particles at very high speed, it creates the energy which you can equate to, some they say, a minor black hole. How a scientist that he has seen dealt with that problem?
Okay, so you're probably talking about creation of many black holes. So what happens is that, again, go to the classical picture of, let's say, gravity. The idea is that if you, let's take a core from one proton and a core from another proton, and they collide. The size is so small the energy density is so large that you can't create a black hole, because the density in that local point is very high. And you have this notion of the Schwarzschild radius, which comes in. So these are semi-classical black holes, which could be produced. And so we look for them. So if they were produced, then they would decay in a very characteristic manner, because gravity is very democratic in its action. It doesn't favor photons, it doesn't favor neutrinos, it doesn't favor quarks. It couples to them universally. So if you were to produce them, you'd look for events which are very large numbers, high energy particles, all sorts. A symmetric event, but large number of jets, electrons, photons, and so on and so on. So you look for these characteristics, and you don't see them over and above what the theory of quantum thermodynamics predicts. So that's what I haven't got lots of it, so we look for them. And so we've been able to put limits at the level of 7 or 8, 9 TeV in mass. Now, the other thing before you go and say that we are going to create something and then destroy everything, the LHC is quite powerful, as I said, but it is not as powerful as the cosmic accelerator. We are continually bombarded by particles which come from outer space, even higher energies, much higher energies. So in fact, the 1 second of the LHC is at its energy is almost equivalent to 1 second over the entire surface of the Earth, because the number of particles impinging in the upper atmosphere, creating similar interactions as we produce in the accelerator, is equivalent to 1 second. And the Earth has been going for about 5 billion years. So in that sense, if something was going to happen, we wouldn't be here. So it's another type of argument which suggests that the energies are high, but in the universe, there are higher energies. Of course, we're not there to detect, because if you wanted to detect it, you'd have to line the whole surface of the Earth with the CMS detector, which you wouldn't be able to afford that space.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen.